All right. Just a few remarks during the intermission. Some of you came to tell me. One was, what is the relation between flame dynamics and flashback? You know that one of the problems that is produced by combustion dynamics is the fact that the flame can go backwards into the injection system. And this is because the flow velocity can be reduced to a point where the flame is moving upstream. And so when we study combustion dynamics, we don't want to have this happen. So that's a point that we that is also a byproduct of these studies is the analysis of flashback. And there is a very nice film that I don't have, but that probably can be seen. It was done in the 1980s by Tony Oppenheim at Berkeley, where you had a flame stabilized on a bluff body like that in a duct. And when the oscillation was strong, the flame would move upstream, downstream, very large motion. Tony Oppenheim was very good at doing Schlieren, color Schlieren. So you see a beautiful Schlieren movie of that. This was done in the old days with very high speed film and was difficult. Again, it was a time where you didn't have all these cameras that you can now get. The other question was about what is the relation between instabilities, you know, the typical Kelvin-Helmholtz instabilities that you have, and what goes on in these devices. I took back this example of the flame stabilized on a V-gutter. And in this case, it's very special because if you look close to the obstacle, you have a wake. You see the profile here has the shape of a wake. And if you go further downstream, the flow here is accelerated because the gases are heated, so they occupy more volume. And as a consequence here, you have an acceleration, so you have a jet. So this is a flow which begins as a wake and then gives rise to a jet. It's unusual. Those people who don't work on reactive flows don't have that. And here you have something which is unusual. It's a wake becoming a jet. And this is perhaps the reason why the flame is so susceptible to almost all wavelengths. It's interesting. So let's move now to the acoustics. So we begin with a simple the simplest cases. We assume that the thermodynamics is defined by two variables. The fluid will be ideal, viscosity and heat conductivity will be taken equal to zero. No chemical reactions at this point, no volume forces, they are not very important in acoustics. So now we begin with the equations of fluid mechanics. So these equations, you have the mass equation, d rho by dt plus divergence of rho v is equal to zero. Then we have the momentum equation, rho dv by dt. So the vectors are written with this tilde underneath, plus v grad v is equal to minus grad p. This is the Euler equation, and there is no volume force, and there is no viscosity. And then the third equation is written in entropy form. Of course, you know perhaps how it's written in energy form, but you can obtain this equation for the entropy, ds by dt plus v grad s is equal to zero. So these are the basic equations. And in addition, we want to express the pressure as a function of two variables, and here we choose rho and s. But of course, you can write that in various ways. And for example, for a perfect gas, you can write s is equal to cv logarithm of p over rho gamma. And this is an exponent here. And this can be written as p is equal to rho gamma e exponential s over cv. This is, you will see, it's useful to use that. And now we want to get the equations of acoustics. And so the what we do here is that, so this just tells that gamma is equal, of course, the ratio between the specific heats, the constant pressure and the constant volume specific heats. And immediately you see that this equation here tells you that ds by dt is equal to zero. So along a streamline, the entropy is conserved. And if the entropy is the same in the medium, for example, in this room, if the temperature is the same and the pressure is essentially the same, there is almost nothing, no change in pressure here in this room. So basically the entropy is constant. And if you have ds by dt is equal to zero, it means that the entropy will be constant. So basically, acoustic motions are carried out at the constant entropy. There is nothing to change the entropy here. So in fact, we can write already that the entropy is constant everywhere, even during this perturbation. While I'm speaking, I'm not changing the entropy in the room. So now we are going to linearize, because you know, acoustics is a small perturbation. For example, the level of pressure perturbation related to 100 decibels, if you have 100 decibels, what is the pressure perturbation corresponding to 100 decibels? 100 decibels is what you listen when somebody is in his car and puts his radio at the highest level, you know, and everybody listens outside. You've seen these people. Of course, they will be deaf at 40. This will be very harmful, except if they have earplugs. Perhaps they do. I don't know. So anyway, 100 decibels is unbearable. You cannot bear 100 decibels. And how much pressure does that correspond to? What is the pressure of 100 decibels in pascals? Two pascals. You know how many pascals in an atmosphere? In how much? 100,000. 100,000. 10 to the 5. 10 to the 5. So one bar or one atmosphere, one bar. The pressure in the room, one bar, is 10 to the 5 pascals. And the RMS value corresponding to 100 decibels, this is 2 pascals. So you see it's very small. The year you listen to me and your ear is beautiful. It's a sensor which is unbelievable. In addition, you do a lot of processing behind that. You have your ears, you know where the direction of the sound comes from. If you are in a cocktail party and you speak to somebody and everybody is shouting around, you are able to focus on the person you are speaking to. It's a young lady, for example. You know how to do that. or vice versa, whatever. So the ear is remarkable, and of course the brain behind it is also remarkable, because not only are you understanding the words, but you are also analyzing the frequency. So you have a spectral analysis going on all the time. You listen to music, you listen to this frequency, but and so it is extremely precise. It can listen to much less than 2 pascals, 0.2 pascals or even lower, and it gives you this capacity to do spectral analysis, and you can also, using your 2 ears, because we have it's a system which allows you to say the sound is coming from this direction. So it's absolutely beautiful. So anyway, acoustics is a very small perturbation. So what we can do here is say, well, the pressure is the mean pressure, P0 plus P1. And P1 is very small compared to P0. And we can say there is a velocity which accompanies this acoustic wave. V is equal to V0 plus V1. But here, in this case, V0, we will consider first that there is no flow. So there is no flow. So, but the velocity will be small. This velocity will be small compared to the speed of sound. And then S will be equal to S0 plus S1. But we've seen that S1 is equal to 0. And then rho, the density, will be equal to rho will be equal to rho 0 plus rho 1. And rho 1 is very small compared to rho 0. And so the idea here is to do linearization. That is, we take all these expressions. For example, we take the mass equation here. Divergence of rho 0 plus rho 1. And here we have already a perturbation in velocity here. The velocity that is associated with acoustics is very small. You don't feel it, in fact. Except if you put, for example, your hand close to your mouth, you see that there is a little bit of velocity there. Or you have a loudspeaker on your radio, you put your hand, you see that it moves there. The momentum equation becomes rho 0 plus rho 1 d by dt of v1 plus v1 gradient of v1, and this is minus gradient of p0 plus p1. And so let's look at these two equations first, and afterwards we will look at the equation of state. So what can we do? Well, rho 0 is constant, so it goes out from here. Rho 1 v1, this is a second order term. This one is first order multiplied by first order, makes second order. So this one can be neglected. So this equation, the first equation, becomes d rho 1 by dt plus rho 0. Rho 0 is a constant, so you can take it out. Divergence of v1 is equal to 0. And this one, the second one, becomes, now rho 1 is first order. This is first order, so that can be neglected. And this one is, again, second order, that can be neglected. This is a difficult term in fluid mechanics. It's the convective term, and it's neglected here. So basically, the momentum equation becomes rho 0 times dv1 by dt is equal to minus gradient of p1. So the equations are greatly simplified here. Yeah, this comes out because it's constant. So these are the two equations, linearized. And we have now to linearize the state equation. P is equal to P of rho and S. So what we do here is to write a Taylor series. So we place P of rho 0, S 0. And now S is constant. So when we do the Taylor series, we only change the density. So it makes dP by d rho at S constant times rho 1 plus 1 half dP d2p by d rho square times rho 1 square. So this is second order, can be neglected. And here p is equal to p0 plus p1. And what is p of rho 0 and s0? It's p0. And here we have dp by d rho at constant entropy times rho 1. So finally, p0 goes out, and we have p1 is equal, I'm going to call that c squared. You see that this quantity is like a velocity square. You will see that it's the speed of sound square in a minute. So here, this is c squared times rho 1. So there is a very simple relation, it's algebraic, between the density and the pressure, and the proportionality is through c squared. So what do we have? We have p1 is equal to c squared rho 1. We have d rho 1 by dt plus divergence of v1 is equal to 0. And we have rho 0 dv1 by dt is equal to minus gradient of p1. So we can see that here. You see the steps that we just took are shown here. The principle of linearization is to drop out the second order terms. And I showed you before that the pressure is very small. The velocity that we will calculate, you will see, is also very small. You can really neglect second order terms. And this goes like that. The Taylor series, to get the last equation, is just the fact that the entropy is constant, so you don't have a change due to this entropy. This will not be the case in reactive flows where the entropy will change, of course, but we'll see that later. So what we find is this group of equations, the group which is here. And just to begin, you can wonder, what is this C square? What does C square look like? Well, C square, as I told you, it will be recognized, it will be identified as the speed of sound square. But it's nice to, we haven't seen that yet. Of course, you've encountered that before. For example, if you do compressible fluid dynamics, you see that this quantity is actually the speed of sound square. Now, what is the value of this quantity? C square is dp by d rho at constant S. And this is equal to rho gamma minus 1 gamma e to the S over cv. And this can be written as gamma p over rho. This is, in fact, gamma times p divided by rho. And we know also that p is equal to rho rt. This is the relation between the pressure, density, and temperature. And r is the universal gas constant divided by the molecular mass, molecular weight. And so, so the speed of sound square can be written as C square is equal to gamma R T. Of course, here we use the temperature that is in the room. And for example, if you want to calculate that at the room temperature, you see that you take R is equal to 8,314. You divide by 29, which is in between 32 and 28. But you have more nitrogen than oxygen, so it's 29. And you have 287. This is very practical. Like that, you can use this expression is very practical for engineering. You can immediately calculate your pressures, temperatures, and so on. So the speed of sound is 1.4 times that, all of that to the power 1/2, and it makes 346 meters per second. So it's nice to know. It's also nice to know that it is going to change like the square root of the temperature. So now, of course, these expressions here, you are very tempted to eliminate one of the variables. And the variable that can be eliminated is the density, because there is this relation here, and we can write these equations just in terms of pressure and velocity by just using this last equation. And so we can write 1 over c squared dp1 by dt plus rho 0 divergence of v1 is equal to 0. And then the other one is rho 0 dv1. So this is the linearized momentum equation plus gradient of p1 is equal to 0. So the two variables here for acoustics, if you want to do acoustics in this room, you have these equations. These are the linearized Euler equations. And of course, you can still retain the fact that p1 and rho 1 are related by this expression. So this is another set here. And now it's also possible to get a wave equation. And the wave equation may be simply obtained by taking, you take the differential of the first with respect to time, and of the second, you take the divergence and subtract one from the other. So we take d by dt of this one, and we take divergence of that one and subtract. So you see 1 over c square d2p 1 by dt square. Plus rho 0 d by dt of divergence of v1. And then we subtract minus rho 0. And now the operators are linear, and so they interchange. And you can, again, put dt d by dt of divergence of v1 minus the divergence of the gradient, it's the Laplacian of p1 is equal to 0. So these two terms vanish. And so we get the wave equation. And this indicates that indeed c is the speed of the waves here. You see, by writing that equation, you learn that c squared is the speed to the power 2. So this is the wave equation. And what happens to the others? Well, you have to keep the other equation. At least the momentum equation is important. the linearized momentum is, for example, important if you want to set up boundary conditions. You should not just say, well, I don't care. No, it comes in a couple, and you need that equation. And of course, you can always calculate the density perturbation associated with acoustic waves like that. So I perhaps too much time to derive that, but like that, you cannot say these were parachuted. You got them. If anybody hasn't understood these calculations, please tell me. They are simple. Acoustics is a simpler version of fluid mechanics. But nevertheless, it has a lot of complexities, despite the fact that it's a simplified fluid mechanics. So this is the set. Of course, when you do theoretical acoustics, you will be working with the wave equation and with this set here. And now some of the topics that I'm going to look at more briefly are, first of all, propagation in one dimension. Of course, for up to here, we looked at three dimensions, but what happens when you have propagation in one direction only? Time and one direction. So the system simplifies. For example, when you have this system here, and you multiply the first equation by c square, and you, instead of having the divergence, you have just dv by dx. And the momentum equation, which is here, and of course I dropped the one, which indicates that it's a perturbation, but you can, so this is dropped. And this one becomes rho zero dv by dt plus dp by dx is equal to zero. And the wave equation becomes this one-dimensional wave equation here, d2p by dx square minus 1 over c square d2p by dt square. And this can be actually factored. So when you see that, you immediately understand that by changing the variable into psi is equal to t minus x over c, and eta is equal to t plus x over c, this will be changed in an equation which looks like that. You see, it's an exercise that is always done in mathematics. I hope you've done it once. If you didn't, tonight, this is a homework. So you take this one, and what you find is d2p by d psi d eta is equal to zero. So what does that mean? You see, you find, this is by changing variables. It takes a little calculation, not much. But it tells you that with these new variables, you have d2p by d xi d eta is equal to zero. So it means that d by d xi of a quantity which is dp by d eta is equal to zero. So as a consequence, you see that the quantity dp by d eta does not depend on xi. So you can say dp by d eta is only a function of eta. So let's call it g of eta. Because here you see that the derivative with respect to psi is equal to zero. So you have that. And this can be integrated. And you say now p is the integral of some g of eta, d eta. But the constant which comes in here can depend on xi. So this will be something like, let's say, call it f of xi. It's a constant with respect to eta, but it can be a function of xi. So basically what you have here is the sum of two functions, one which depends on Xi and one which I will call G of eta. So the solution of the wave equation in one dimension is known. It's something which looks like that. So more clearly, it looks like this. P is equal to F of T minus X over C plus G of T plus X over C. You see, this is the general solution of that equation. So you can place in this equation, F can be whatever you want, and G can be whatever you want. It's all functions work. This is the general solution of the wave equation. And what is the velocity corresponding to that? The velocity can be obtained using the momentum equation. So you know that the momentum was written rho 0 dv by dt plus dp by dx is equal to 0. And now let's take, for example, F. Let's assume that P is equal to F of t minus x over c. Now, if the pressure is like that, if you put that in this equation, the velocity which is here has to be also a function of the same variable. If it were different, it wouldn't work. It would not be able to, it would not be coherent. So basically, you can say immediately that the velocity has also to be, let's say, let's call it a function, let's call it again F, but not the F which is there. Anyway, let's call it F of T minus X over C. And now we put that into this equation, and we get, it's always important to know what is the velocity corresponding to the pressure. So we take these expressions, and so dv by dt will be F prime. The derivative is taken with respect to psi, this rho zero. And dp by dx, you see when I take the derivative of F with respect to xi, it's here. And by x, there is a minus 1 over c. So it makes minus 1 over c F prime is equal to 0. So basically, big F prime is equal to 1 over rho 0 c F prime. And this can be integrated with respect to xi. And of course, there is a constant coming in here, but it's not important. It's not a wave, so the constant can be dropped. And so what we learn is that F is equal to 1 over rho 0 c small f. So what does it say? It says that v, the velocity, is 1 over rho 0 c f of t minus x over c. And for the other wave, for this one, for g of t plus x over c, we would have a velocity v which will be minus 1 over rho 0 c, because there is a change in sign, and it makes that of t plus x over c. So in conclusion of all that, in one dimension, what we learned here is that the pressure, you see the pressure here, p is the sum of two functions, two general functions. You can choose what you want. F of t minus x over c plus g of t plus x over c. And the velocity here is 1 over rho 0 c times f of t minus x over c minus g of t of x over c, like that. So the one part of the knowledge here is this ratio between the pressure and the velocity here. You see the so we have these expressions. This I derived it all in detail like that again. You know that things are like that. The calculations are very simple here. And what are these waves? You see this wave here is a wave which travels to the right at the speed of sound. How do you know that? I will show in a minute. And this one travels to the left with the speed of sound. And you see between the pressure, which is here, and this one, you have 1 over rho 0 c. So the velocity is the pressure divided by rho 0 c. So if you want to know what is the velocity corresponding to a given pressure for a wave traveling here, you take, for example, 2 pascals and divide by rho 0 c. Rho 0 in this atmosphere is how much? In air, what is the rho 0? 1.2 kilograms per cubic meter. C, 346. Rho 0 c is 400. So you have 2 divided by 400. It makes 1 divided by 200. It's less than a centimeter per second. So 2 pascals is a centimeter per second. It's not much. So the velocity is very small. But as you go up to in pascals, for example, if you have instabilities at 140 decibels, so you have to bring down, it's 2,000 pascals, and then you divide by 400, it makes a few meters per second. So then it becomes important, but still small. So how do you know which way the wave goes? You take, for example, the function, which is this one, at time t1, and then you look at where does that function go when you take something like that, and you find that it goes, it's displaced by c times the difference in time, it goes in the right direction. And the other wave goes in the other direction. And you see this quantity, rho zero c, is the impedance. It's the acoustic impedance, the specific acoustic impedance. What we call impedance is the pressure divided by the velocity. So, for example, you know that impedance is a very important concept. The impedance is how something will respond to a force. In mechanics, it's the force divided by the velocity. In electricity, the impedance is, what is it? Impedance in electricity. It's, what do you have on the upper side of the voltage divided by intensity. And in acoustics, it's pressure divided by velocity. So for example, if you have an infinite impedance, it means that velocity is zero, and whatever the pressure you impose, you have zero velocity. So the notion of impedance is, for example, important when you do echography. Who has been subjected to echography? You know, when the doctor wants to look at what happens somewhere in you? You haven't been examined for... No? Nobody has seen that? No? For... Sonography. It's echography. It's using ultrasound to look at images. Have you been submitted to that? Yeah. So what does the doctor? He puts the antenna on your body, and you have the body behind that. So you have a... This is the body here. I'm showing somebody who may be pregnant, for example. You want to see the baby, and it's very fun. And you put the antenna here, and so you send sound here and comes back, and using processing, you get an image. It's beautiful. But to be able, so that the waves get in here, you have to understand that the impedance here, the specific impedance is rho zero C. So this is, rho zero is typically like water. We are 85% water, so it makes 1,000. And the speed of sound in water, what is it? 1,500 times 1,500. So the impedance here is about 10 to the 6. And air, the impedance in air is 400. So if you put the antenna without anything here, you're going to have a very strong change in impedance, and the waves will be reflected. Nothing will get into the body. So the doctor puts a gel. So you have a gel between the antenna and your body, and like that, the waves get in without any problem. So here you place a gel. And just to tell you that impedance is important, and that when you have a break in impedance, it doesn't work. The waves, so that the waves will travel, you have to have equal impedance across the body, across the system. All right. So let's now go to harmonic waves. Here we looked at time-dependent systems, but we are very interested in systems at a given frequency. Why? First of all, because most of the mechanical systems are very sensitive to frequency. You know that certain frequencies will be resonances, and you want to avoid them, or on the other hand, use them. So the analysis at a given frequency is very useful. Spectral analysis is very useful. You always want to know where is the energy. For example, you are on a boat and you are seasick. Why are you seasick? Because the waves move up and down at a frequency which is lower than your own body frequency. Your typical frequency is 1 hertz. You walk at 1 hertz. And so if the waves go up and down at 0.1 hertz, you feel dizzy. So this is a typical situation where you are very sensitive to frequency. So anyway, so we want to study systems at a given angular frequency. This is a typical writing. So the convention, the right convention is this one. This one is the most accepted convention in acoustics, except for some British. The British are always somewhat special. So they put a plus. So when they put a plus here, everything is upside down. But you can say, if they put a plus, I use J, so J, e to the J omega t, and then I say J is equal to minus I, and everything is done. So here, and when you write something like that, you use complex numbers. Of course, complex numbers are very useful because everything can be written down easily using complex numbers. And so once you've done your calculations, you take the real part, because of course you don't see a complex number in front of you. You see the real part of the field, and this is what you do. So for example, what happens when you have these expressions? Let's take, for example, the wave equation, but you can do it also for all the other equations. So if you write the pressure, if you write the pressure as a pressure is P omega, so it says it's the field at the frequency, the angular frequency omega of x, e to the minus I omega t. When you do dp by dt, this gives minus I omega P omega e to the minus I omega t. And if you do again d2p by dt square, this gives minus I omega square P omega e to the minus omega t. In fact, as soon as you do d by dt, it introduces minus I omega. So when you put that into the wave equation, 1 over c squared d2p by dt squared minus Laplacian of p is equal to 0, you take that expression, put that here, what you get is minus omega squared over c squared p omega minus Laplacian of p omega. And like that, what you get here is an equation which does not depend on time anymore. This equation can be written Laplacian of p omega plus k squared p omega is equal to 0, and k is equal to omega over c. So this is what we call the wave number. And this is the Helmholtz equation. This equation is simpler than the wave equation because there is no more, the time is not there anymore. It's an equation which looks very much like the Laplace equation. You know, the Laplace equation would be Laplacian of phi is equal to 0. Here you have a little more because you have k squared times p, which comes in the picture. This is the Helmholtz equation. So when we study fields in harmonic fields, they obey the Helmholtz equation. And of course, this equation is an elliptic equation that can be solved rather easily with finite elements. So you can now, using the computer, you can really solve that in a very, very rapidly, even in complicated geometries. So you access the modes, for example, of a system in a very simple way by solving this Helmholtz equation, even in three dimensions. And so this is the basic equation that we have to solve. And of course, we have to keep the momentum equation. The momentum equation written for harmonic waves is, so it was written rho 0 dv by dt, dv1 by dt, plus gradient of p1 is equal to 0. And so this gives minus rho 0 I omega v omega. So this is the velocity corresponding to the pressure field, plus gradient of p omega is equal to 0. So this has to be kept. This is useful for setting, for example, boundary conditions. So you use that, and you use that to solve for fields, harmonic fields. So let's look at what happens in one dimension. So here it's again it's a simplification here, because we look at waves which are harmonic and in one dimension. And in one dimension, the Helmholtz equation becomes very simple. It's a differential equation, which is just simply d2p by dx squared. So I'm going to drop the omega here. Let's put it again once, but afterwards we'll drop it. So this equation has well-known solutions. You know that the pressure p omega is equal to e to the I kx. There is also e to the minus I kx. And there is A here and B here. So the pressure field is given by that expression. And you have to remember that all that, as always here, e to the minus I omega t. But this is just in your mind. You don't write it. You don't need to write it, except when you want to calculate the field, you take the real part of that and you have the field. So that's what you have here. And it's a simple matter to see that the velocity v omega is 1 over rho 0 c times a to the I kx minus b to the e I minus I kx. And here again, e to the minus I omega t. So here you have expressions for one dimension. And the first problem, which is worked out here, is an infinite duct. So what, and the duct is begins with a piston. So you have a piston which moves at a given velocity. It's accelerated. It has a certain velocity here. And the velocity is given by that expression, v0 cosine omega t. So what is the field in the duct? What is the pressure field that is generated in this duct? So the how to deal with that? Well, we write v0. So this is the velocity at the piston is real part of v0 exponential minus I omega t. We write the pressure. Now, the pressure is formed of two waves. One wave, this wave here, is moving to the positive x direction. This one is moving negative x direction. So if the duct is infinite, there is no return. The only wave which is there is only this one. So you can immediately say, in this case, that the pressure in the duct, you don't know the value, the amplitude of the pressure. You don't know that yet, but you know that the pressure will be A times exponential I kx minus I omega t. At least it's the real part of that. Basically, in the duct, what you have is P is equal to real part of that. What you measure is something like that. So this is the pressure, and the velocity will be the real part of A divided by rho 0 c times e to the I kx minus I omega t, because there is no wave coming back. It's only a wave which moves away from the piston. And now what we can say is that this velocity has to match the velocity at the piston. So we take this at x is equal to 0. So v at 0 and t is equal to real part of A over rho 0 c times e to the minus I omega t. And this has to match the velocity, which is equal to v0, a real part of v0 e to the minus I omega t. And so immediately we see that A over rho 0 c has to be equal to v0. So the amplitude of the pressure field, A, is equal to rho 0 c v0. That's it. And so the pressure field inside the duct so we have the pressure field inside the duct. It's the real part. It's the real part of A times e to the I kx minus omega t. So this is written as P is equal to rho 0 c times v0 cosine of kx minus omega t. So this is what you actually measure in the duct. If you know the velocity, for example, it's 1 meters per second, you have a pressure which is 400 pascals, absolute. And you have a cosine kx minus omega t, and that's, so we solve the problem here. This is the simplest problem in terms of duct acoustics. So this is the expression of the pressure field in the duct. That's what you would measure by placing microphones on your duct. The second problem is now to look at the modes. So what is a mode? It's a solution of the Helmholtz equation which satisfies the boundary conditions. And not all solutions satisfy the boundary conditions, and not at all frequencies. So we find here the eigenfrequencies and the eigenstructures in the duct. So you see here what we have is again this equation. This is the Helmholtz equation. And let's suppose that the duct is closed here and open here. When it is closed, it means that the velocity has to be zero. So it means that the pressure gradient has to be zero at this closed end. And when it's open here, basically the pressure, this is a pressure release boundary. And so the pressure at that point is essentially zero. In fact, it's not quite zero. It's zero a little at a certain distance from the duct. It's 0.8 of the radius or something like that. So basically, when you put a microphone at the duct end, the pressure is not quite zero. It's just there. It's zero. But let's assume that the pressure is zero here. So here is the problem that we have to solve. D2P by dx squared plus k squared p is equal to zero, and these two boundary conditions. Is there any solution for that? This is the pressure. It has these two components. And the first condition immediately tells you that A has to be equal to B. And the second condition has to tell you that this plus that has to be zero, so that cosine KL has to be zero. So this gives you a dispersion relation that we call d of omega is equal to zero. And the only values which give you that are given by kn. It's an odd multiply of pi over 2l. To get that, you need that. And if you look at that, you find immediately that the frequencies are 2n plus 1, c over 4l, and the eigenmodes are given by cosine of kn of x with the kn's given before. So the wavelengths that are associated with that are obtained by dividing c by fn, and you see that they are given by 4l divided by 2n plus 1. And the first one is 4l. This is why we call that a quarter wave mode. What does that mean? It means that the length of the duct is a quarter of the wavelengths. And then you have a three-quarter wave mode and a five-quarter wave mode, etc. So these are the wavelengths, the resonant wavelengths or the resonant frequencies here, and these are the structures. So you see we have modes which are solutions of the way of the Helmholtz equation satisfying the boundary conditions, but this happens only at certain particular frequencies which are very important and play the role of resonances. All right, it's 11:03, so let's stop for 15 minutes. So come back at 11:18.